take them out and turn to the book of Proverbs. We finished off at Proverbs chapter 2, verse 10, right in there. So we're going to start Proverbs 2:10. Now, we started this proverb, and it was really emphasizing something that I've been taking with me throughout the week, is the initial verses there, where it gives us an ambition that we need to have to follow after God. It's an ambition. So you remember, he says to receive my words in verse 1, receive them. That means that we would gladly take them in, appreciate them. He says to treasure them within you, to incline your ear, to apply your heart, to cry out for it, to lift up your voice, to seek her as silver. It just goes on like that, the importance of wisdom, the importance of knowing God's ways. And so it's important to understand that there's a passion, an enthusiasm, a hunger that we're to have for God. And a lot of times we don't understand that if we don't have that, if we're dull or complacent or lethargic in our pursuit of God, we think, well, I just want God to give me that hunger. But what we find is, the hunger comes by our seeking, by our going after. So we may not feel hungry. We may not feel ambitious and fired up and passionate. But that comes through our seeking. Because the Bible says God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So it's in the seeking that we get the passion. It's in the applying ourselves to God and to his word, to prioritizing him above all else, to follow him in obedience. It's in that seeking that we will find our passion, that we will find our hunger. And that's really important, isn't it? It's really important that we're hungering and thirsting after righteousness. So as he talks about that, let's go to verse 10. So now he gives us some practical examples of how wisdom helps us. And again, so wisdom is knowing how to do life skillfully. And the right way to do life is to walk with God. That takes skill. It takes wisdom. Wisdom actually means skillfully applying God's knowledge to our situations. So life sometimes, it feels like we're walking a tightrope. Have you ever seen those the footage of tightrope walkers over huge buildings? I think there's a movie out about that. But see, sometimes life is like that. And if we walk skillfully, we'll always be walking correctly. But it takes skill. The skill is given to us in God's word. We have these promises in the Bible. Joshua 1:9 comes to mind. Psalm 1:1 comes to mind. About using and applying God's word in faithful obedience and the promise of success that comes with that. And you may not have success like many of the speakers at graduation ceremonies focus on. Work hard and you can have the whole world, and the whole world's yours, and you have so many, you know, things you can do. Whatever you want to do, you can do. If you believe it, you can achieve it, and all this stuff. I honestly get tired of hearing that, because that's not really true. That's not really true. There's a worldly success that it could be possible. But success in God's eyes is different. Success in God's eyes is being faithful. Success in God's eyes is being faithful. Just faithful. Be faithful. And to be faithful, then you have to. We have to know God, walk with God. We have to understand His heart, His will, and apply ourselves to that. So, wisdom then, in a way, wisdom is staying on the right path. Wisdom is understanding that there are really two paths in life: God's path and that which is not God's path. Skillful living is knowing God's right path. It's knowing each step that we know and discern what the will of God is, and we simply follow that in obedience. So with that, now watch what he says. In verse 10, he says, when wisdom enters your heart and knowledge is pleasant to your soul, discretion will preserve you, understanding will keep you. So the benefits of wisdom, I want you to notice something here. He says, when wisdom enters your heart. So it's not just about knowing information. Do you think we can know information? We can know the things what the Bible says, and yet we can still not walk with God? It's not just knowing the information, is it? It comes down to the heart. That is so key. Think about it like this. Godliness is inward devotion. Inward devotion and outward piety. You got that? So godliness. So it's inward devotion. It's the internal affects the external. Never the other way around. So when we focus on piety, what does that mean? Piety means doing good, pure, doing right things. When we're just trying to be good, and we're focused on the external, but it's not coming from our heart. The outside can affect our heart, but the inside, the heart, can affect the outside. So we can never reverse that order. That's what happens a lot in religion or well-meaning people. You can be not even a Christian. You cannot even have the Holy Spirit living in you, and maybe outwardly have some piety and be kind of a good person, even though your heart is deceitfully wicked. But you can learn behaviors that are acceptable to society and do that really good. And some people are really good about being really good. But see, being a Christian is totally different. Being a Christian is the manifestation of God that's in our heart through our actions. So it's the internal affects the external. When we focus on the internal, that's what's so important that we get. That the Proverbs is not a rule book. It's about our heart wanting and being willing to do whatever God says. And unless we're at that point, we're always going to struggle. If we're always at the place where we're kind of in, kind of out, kind of sort of want to, but not at the cost of things that we may have to give up or things that may be hard. Maybe we put some barriers, some boundaries on the fact that, you know, I'll honor God, but not to this extent and not to this point. Jesus was challenging that rich young ruler said, I'm doing all the stuff really well. I'm good at doing the stuff, the rules. I'm a good rule keeper. And Jesus said, oh yeah, go and sell all your stuff and then come talk to me. Whoa, wait a second. I draw the line there. See, that's what happens. That's what we do. We may not even realize that we have these boundaries or barriers or stipulations on following God until we get to a certain place, life hits us, something happens, And then we're at a crossroads. Now we need wisdom, don't we? Because now it's hard. Now it's a sacrifice. Now I may be losing something. Now I may be stripped of something. Now something may be changing. Now it's hard. Now it's desperate. And I need wisdom. I need skill to now do the right thing where before it was just sort of easy, maybe. Bet this. You're going to be put in a position sometime, somewhere, where you're going to have to exert, walk in faith under extraordinary difficult situations. And that's part of God's plan. You know why? Faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. That's why. Because faith is believing and trusting in God regardless of how things seem, how we think, what we want to do. And I want to encourage you now, take a step of faith and say, I will follow you, Lord, without any boundaries or restrictions. And pray that God would give you the strength to do that. Because we can't do it on our own. But you know what? When God commands us to do something, he then follows it with the equipping to carry it through. He never commands us to have faith and says, now it's up to you to do that. And then the ones who are better at it win. It doesn't work like that. God says, have faith. And then he says, now I will give you the strength to do. Walk in that. God is so good like that. But see, that's how we grow. That's how we grow. So when he says wisdom in verse 10, when wisdom enters our heart, notice it's certain it's a heart thing. It's not just knowing it. It's a heart thing. When it goes there, it says, and knowledge is pleasant to your soul. When we pursue God with all of our heart, you know what happens? This is interesting. It may take a little while. There may be some refining fires that have to burn some of the impurities out of our life. But you know what you'll find, what I have found, and I'm continually finding, is when God reveals his way, his truth, his insight, his understanding, it's so enjoyable and so pleasant that becomes wonderful. That becomes greater than any earthly pleasure that we can have. It's a delight to know the Lord. It's pleasurable, it's pleasant, it's good stuff, in other words. But sometimes we have to hang in there to get there. We saw last week how the wisdom of the Lord and the stuff that God gives, it, the insights and the revelation and the truth and the understanding, the application, that God just doesn't throw that around. Just like an IndyCar driver wouldn't drive up and just flip his keys to somebody in driver's training and say, go for it. See, God, he gives these incredible things to a heart that's ready for it. And it's a progressive thing, too. We can continue to grow in the goodness and the blessing in the inside of the Lord. And that's why it could be a life pursuit. So watch this. And then in verse 11, he says, discretion will preserve you and understanding will keep you. So what he's saying is, discretion, the ability to distinguish, to tell the difference in certain situations, when something's wrong and something's right, to be able to have an ability, even when all the people may be saying it's right, but you know something is not off. Something is off. Something doesn't feel right about this. I have a discerning spirit that we're able then to make decisions wisely. And what he's saying is that's something that'll keep you in life. That's something that will preserve you. So you don't have a life that's all out of control and spinning wildly in every direction that the wind blows. But it's a life that is steady and consistent in the ways of the Lord. So then now he starts to get specific and he talks about a man. So in verse 12, to deliver you from the way of evil, from the man who speaks perverse things. So we get a description, and we don't know if that's a specific man, but we know that there are specific men, specific people that are perverse and that are looking to bring us into their perversity. The ultimate man who does that is Satan. And so now wisdom is how we negotiate the evils of the world that are after us. The things of the world that are looking to draw us into its net. I'm not just talking about a fisherman's net. I'm talking about the internet. A new mode of operandi of Satan to draw people in to his clutches. There's a perversity that is spewed out. There is a new vehicle for Satan to come inside of people's houses, inside of people's bedrooms, inside of people's safe places, their sanctuaries, their havens, and now Satan can use that to deprave the minds even of those well-seeking, well-intentioned people. If they are not wise, they will be caught up in that net as well. So he says in verse 13, he says, from those who leave the paths of uprightness to walk in the ways of darkness. A lot of times we don't understand the evil that's behind the things that are looking to draw us in. Usually we have a really good way, when I say good, it's with quotes, a good way of justifying sin or minimizing sin. We have a good way of seeing other people's sin and not our own. Really weird the way we're wired, the way we don't understand the darkness and the evil behind what's happening. And imagine if we could really see the forces of darkness behind the sin and the evil. Imagine what that would be like. We'd be terrified. We'd be terrified of it. But see, we already know, but now it's faith that tells us and helps us to see the power of the darkness. So we have to then say it. And remember this. I just read in the book of Ezekiel chapter 6, God doesn't say anything in vain, it says. Do you know what that means? That means that there's no minutia in this. What's minutia? God doesn't use flowery language. He doesn't use more words than necessary. He's not like a modern day novelist that has to fluff everything up. Every single word, no, not word. Every single letter, no, not letter. Every single jot and tittle, what's that? The dot of the I and the cross of the T, all that is meaningful. You know, that'll change the way you read your Bible. Did you know that? You read your Bible knowing every single thing in there. And of course, this is a translation. We're talking about the original, but I think we can pretty much know every single thing that we have here is God's perfect word for us. Every bit of it. And he doesn't waste anything. And so when he says something, for sure it's going to happen. If he says something, for sure, he doesn't waste a single breath. He doesn't waste a single letter. He doesn't waste a single thing. And he's telling us that there is darkness behind the evil and the perverse ways of people in our day and age. Can we tell the difference? Do we say it's not that bad? Do we say it's no big deal? Do we say it won't hurt me? Do we say, even though Jesus said a little leaven leavens what? Even though Jesus said a little leaven leavens a whole lump, in this case it won't. Are we compromising? That's the thing. I'm reading right here with you guys. There's darkness that we will walk in when we take the offer, the suggestion, the hook, the bait of the perverse man, of the perverse ways, and that's any way that's not of the Lord's way. Here's the heart of God, though. Sometimes we think, God just doesn't want me to have fun. Like, if I really follow the Lord, what will that look like? Like, is it just going to be really boring and I'm just going to be around all these nerdy people? All they'd like to do is read all the time and pray and stuff. Do you really think God's like that? Do you really think that's the way God is? Follow me and you're going to be the most bored you've ever been out of your life. Really? Do you really think that? We got to give God more credit, don't we? God's a wild God. Like I said, I'm reading the book of Ezekiel. All sort of crazy, wild stuff's happening in there. Have you read the book of Revelation? Are you kidding me? We have to trust and understand darkness is only destruction. Don't buy into that. And true wisdom, the Bible says, is to fear the Lord. To fear the Lord, and fearing the Lord is to hate evil. And I'm sure all of us here, all of us, especially me, can hate evil more. Can hate evil more. So we need to take these things seriously. But look what he says in verse 14. He says, these perverse people walking in darkness, enticing us to walk in darkness, he says, they rejoice in doing evil. How good of a description is that of what is going on in our day and age? They're celebrating evil. And they celebrate it on TV, and they celebrate it on YouTube, and in commercials, and on Twitter, and they're celebrating. Woo, darkness, yeah. He says, don't fall into that trap. He says that they even delight in the perversity of the wicked. He says, whose ways are crooked and who are devious in their paths. So that's the one. That's the one example why we need wisdom. Because as we see the description here being pointed out, we face these attacks every single day. Every second we're facing these attacks. And then he gives us another example. This time it's a female example. He says also wisdom to deliver you from the immoral woman, from the seductress who flatters with her words, who forsakes the companion of her youth and forgets the covenant of her God. So now we get this picture of a woman now trying to bring people into her net, trying to trap people. And how does she do it? She does it through seduction, and she does it through flattering words. There's something about the way God made men that they like to be told all the time how great they are. They like to feel so important. These immoral women who seem to have some sort of relationship with God, they know how to, quote unquote, work it. They know how to work the angles. They know the mind of men and how easily men are lured into these traps. They know how to speak. They know how to flirt. They know how to carry themselves. They know how to hold themselves, all in ways to draw the susceptible, vulnerable man into their net. And remember, Satan is behind all this, driving this seduction. So he says in verse 18, he says, "For her house leads down to death, and her paths to the dead." Now, wouldn't that be a good scripture to put right over our computers or whatever, our phones, have it on our phone somewhere? Think about this. So God's telling us this, right? Do we think that that's not going to be where it leads if God's telling this? Are we willing to try it if God's saying this? And through observation, I'm sure we see and have seen the destruction and the hurt and the harm and the pain that has been caused, and not just the internet, but through immorality and immoral, inappropriate relationships throughout the history of mankind. But now we have a sexually charged society where now we don't even really distinguish between a male and female. Where is that coming from? That's perversity. That's all it is. There's no other way to say that we're kind of the same, or I feel like this, or feel that's just perversity. It really is. And so now we have a society like that, that's sending signals and messages to the vulnerable, to the impressionable teenage brain over and over and over again. And the Bible tells us that her house leads down to death and her paths to the dead. That's where it's going. Not going any other place. It's going to death and the dead. Notice in verse 19 how serious this is. He says, "No one who go to her return, nor do they regain the paths of life." That's pretty heavy duty, right? Now, a couple things I want to say here. That word, when it says, "and her paths lead to the dead," that's a word that they would use for a track or a path that was worn because it was constantly used. Okay? This isn't talking about somebody that fell into the sin as a Christian and now you can't be saved. There's only one unforgivable sin. You guys know what that is. It's blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. Right? That's only unforgivable. So what does that mean? Blasphemy of the Holy Spirit means that one rejects the Holy Spirit. The only way any of us can get saved is by the Holy Spirit leading us to Jesus Christ. If we reject that, we can't be saved because we can't get to Christ. We're not going to do it on our own. That's why the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit is the unforgivable sin, because we won't go to forgiveness because we reject the Holy Spirit who's leading us to forgiveness. So be that as it may, this is talking about a person who's gotten caught as an unbeliever in a path, a well-worn path of going back and forth into this sin. Verse 19, where it says, none who go to her return, nor do they regain the paths of life. That word in verse 19, go, in the Greek, it's in the present tense and it's a verb. Present tense and it's a verb, meaning it's a lifestyle. So this is not a falling into sin. This is not a struggling with this sin. This is a lifestyle. This is what somebody does. Now, for the Christian that is stuck in a sexually immoral lifestyle, studies have come out now that they're saying, Barna did a study that they found that 77% of men are regularly looking at pornography on the internet. Christian men in the church, active in the church. So this is a problem. This is obviously a problem. And it's a problem that God wants to deal with within the church, because it's causing so much hurt and darkness within the church. So someone might say, well, I can't change. I can't get out of this. I'm stuck. What's the answer? The answer is really simple. If you're stuck in that sin, the real answer is you don't want to change. Because when we have Christ in us, we have the power to walk in righteousness. If we're real honest with ourselves, the real honesty part, we'd really realize that we really don't want that to not exist in our life anymore. Because if we get to that place, it can be gone. Because of the blood of Christ and the power of Christ. James tells us, here's the thing. When we're dealing with an addiction, when we're dealing with something that has a real hold on us, he says the first thing to do is to submit it to God. To submit it to God. Now that's the part where I really think we really don't want to change if we're stuck in that, because we haven't given it to God. And maybe we kind of do that. Maybe it's like we bury a hatchet, but we leave the handle out. Or do any of you have hide keys in your car? Does anybody have one? You're not going to tell, are you? Smart. Hide keys, a little magnetic thing you stick underneath your hood of your car so nobody can see you hide it. It's a magnet. And your key's in this little container. So if you lose your keys, you got a hide key. There it is. Some of us are like that. We're not really submitting it to God. We're kind of doing that, or temporarily doing that, or we're putting away for a moment, or getting it out of view, or we're feeling bad about it and guilty, so we want to do something about it, but we're really not getting rid of it. We're really not turning and walking the other way. We really kind of want it lingering around just in case. We really kind of can't imagine that never being a part of our life anymore. So just in case, if that's what's happening, we're not serious about it. First thing is submit to God. Really give it to the Lord and let it be gone. When we give it to the Lord, let it be gone. Submit to the Lord, and then it says, resist the devil. That means that you and I, or whoever, we may have a desire to go back to it. Because, see, the problem with sin is once we cross a barrier or a boundary, now we have familiarity with it. Now Satan can use things to trigger our minds. He can use things to remind us, because now we know what it's like. We've experienced it. So much better not to be familiar with evil, like in the Garden of Eden. But there's redemption in the Lord. So if we are, then submitted to God, that means get it out. And then resist the devil, because you be sure he's going to say, do you really want it out? You sure you want it out? Remember what it was like? We can do this again. It's no big deal. You just pray for forgiveness right after. And you start going through all, and then now you're in a battle, right? Well, wait a second. Let's go back to step one. No, it's not around anymore. No, I've walked away from that. No, it's gone. So now we've submitted to the Lord. Now we're resisting the devil. That may hurt. That may be hard. But God has given us the strength to do it, right? In the power of the Holy Spirit. But don't just say, no, 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 no. Then draw near to God. Can't just be left all saying no all the time. Now we have to draw near to God. Now we have to get into our word, saturate our minds with the word of God, worship the Lord, praise the Lord, meditate on the Lord, which the Bible says to meditate on him day and night. Don't leave a little opening. Wash your mind by the word of God, and now you're having victory. Now you're walking in victory. Now you're dealing a death blow to Satan. Now you're punking Satan. Now you're saying, you know what? You don't have power over me. God has saved me and rescued me. And now you're walking in freedom. That's how it works. We may say, you know, I don't know. I don't know if I can do that. Well, then you have to be willing to pay the price. You have to be. The Bible promises that there's a price. We just read it, the darkness. But when we say, I can't stop doing that, I can't submit it to the Lord, I can prove that we can. So say it's internet pornography. We would never do that if somebody like our spouse or friend was standing right next to us. We sneak around and do it, right? So why can we stop when nobody is around, or when somebody's around, but when they're not, then we can't stop? That just proves that we can if we really want to. This is doing battle, right? This is doing battle with Satan. Hey, it may not be the immoral woman. It may be 100 other things. I didn't want to just pick on the one thing, but obviously it's talking about sexual immorality. But hey, if we're honest, let's really look and say, Lord, what is my thing that's keeping me from having the full relationship with you? What is it? What is it in my heart? Because I want to be pure in my heart before you. So in verse 19, and then he says, no one go to her return, nor do they regain the paths of life. And then now the good part. I'm glad we're out of that part. So you may walk in the way of goodness. After all I just said, how does that sound? To walk in the way of goodness. And that's the beautiful thing, that we have the opportunity, no matter what we've done, we have the opportunity to repent, to be restored, to be redeemed, and to walk in the goodness of the Lord. That's the beautiful thing about God's grace and his mercy and his forgiveness. And this is why God doesn't say, sin is bad because I say so. He's saying, I don't want you to walk in a way that's harmful. I love you too much Just like if you had kids and you wouldn't want them to walk into the lion's den or a gorilla cage or on train tracks or on the freeway, it's because you don't want them to get hurt. That's why God says this. He says, I have so much better for you. I have goodness for you. And the dirt and the grime and the darkness and the sleaziness and the ugliness of the world, I can redeem you from all of that and put you on the path of my goodness. That is amazing to me. Amen. And then he says, for the upright will dwell in the land and the blameless will remain in it, but the wicked will be cut off from the earth and the unfaithful will be uprooted from it. So bottom line, we see in those last two verses, basically there's two paths in life. And we all are going to be challenged in different ways and in similar ways. But all that really matters is that we continue walking in God's ways. If we stay focused on that, really doesn't matter the other things around us. And if we've gotten off God's path, repent, be restored, and walk in the goodness and the glory of the Lord. Because he is so good. Amen. And his ways are so amazing and so wonderful. And so we're just going to end right there. Finish chapter 2 tonight. Get into chapter 3 next week. Please join me in prayer, and then we'll worship the Lord.